Nimrod is a legendary biblical figure of the book of Genesis and Chronicles. This occurred after Noah's time, and Noah's son Ham had four sons, Cush, Mizraim, Put, and Canaan. Cush was the forerunner of the Ethiopian people. This is confirmed by the fact that the names Cush and Ethiopia are used interchangeably in the scriptures. Mizraim was the forerunner of the Egyptian people, who are understood in scripture to have been a Hamitic people, and thus African. Psalm 78:51, "And smote all the firstborn in Egypt, the chief of their strength in the tabernacles of Ham." Psalm 105:23, "Israel also came into Egypt, and Jacob sojourned in the land of Ham." Put was the progenitor of Libya. Canaan was the progenitor of the Canaanites, one of the most problematic foes of God's chosen people, the Israelites. In Genesis, Nimrod is a particularly significant, powerful figure, the descendant of Cush, who ruled over the land of Shinar. Nimrod eventually became the father of two of the Bible's and world history's greatest empires, Assyria and Babylon. He was the first world civilization's great leader. Regrettably, he also led the world astray from God. First, what does the name Nimrod mean? It comes from the Hebrew word marad, meaning rebel. Nimrod is mentioned three times in the Bible. Genesis 10, 8-12 is the first and most detailed passage. Cush was the father of Nimrod, who became a mighty warrior on the earth. He was a mighty hunter before the Lord. That is why it is said, "Like Nimrod, a mighty hunter before the Lord." The first centers of his kingdom were Babylon, Uruk, Akkad, and Calneh in Shinar. From that land he went to Assyria, where he built Nineveh, Rehoboth, Ur, Calah, and Rezin, which is between Nineveh and Calah, which is the great city. The next time Nimrod appears is in a genealogy at the beginning of 1 Chronicles. His brief listing in 1 Chronicles 1:10 states, "Cush, the father of Nimrod, who became a mighty warrior on earth." The final passage also mentions Nimrod in passing. Micah 5, 5-6 says, "And he will be our peace when the Assyrians invade our land and march through our fortresses. We will raise against them 7 shepherds, even 8 commanders, who will rule the land of Assyria with the sword, the land of Nimrod with drawn sword. He will deliver us from the Assyrians when they invade our land and march across our borders." According to this passage in Micah, Assyria was still regarded as the land of Nimrod hundreds of years later, at least by the people of God. However, we learn very little about Nimrod. Babel is often thought to be the same as Babylon, which Nimrod is recorded as founding in Genesis 10:10. In fact, some Bible translations actually list this city as Babel rather than Babylon. Genesis 10:10. "And the beginning of his kingdom was Babel, and Erech, and Akkad, and Calneh, and the land of Shinar." The Tower of Babel and Solomon's Temple are possibly the most well-known biblical structures. The Old Testament covers nearly 2,000 years of history prior to Christ. The biblical structure has captivated subsequent generations, despite the fact that everyone has a different idea of what it used to look like. The Tower of Babel was built in the heart of Babylon's thriving metropolis. However, Babylon, known as the City of Cities to the ancients, gradually fell into ruin. People desired to construct a tower that reached into God's sphere of heaven, effectively challenging heaven. According to the text, they wanted to make a name for themselves. We have a rough idea of what the tower would have looked like: a ziggurat, a large brick structure with spiral staircases extending upwards. The tops of such towers were frequently adorned with astrological symbols. But they didn't build that tower to worship stars. Rather, it was to express his own power and grandeur. God was outraged by the Tower of Babel. He said that if he let them continue, there was no telling where it would end. So God gave tongues for the first time, to confuse the people. They could no longer understand each other. From then on, humanity split, scattering and speaking different languages. There is an interesting footnote to the story of Babel. The effect of tongues also takes place on the day of Pentecost. The Holy Spirit descended on 120 disciples in the temple as they gathered in Solomon's porch for morning prayers at 9 a.m. The gift of tongues that accompanied that outpouring was a reversal of God's judgment at the Tower of Babel, Genesis 11, allowing people of many ethnicities to hear Peter's discourse. Approximately 3,000 people were added to the church as a result of their repentance and baptism. Many would later return to their native countries, including Rome, to propagate the word. Genesis 11, 1 through 9. Now the whole world had one language and a common speech. As people moved eastward, they found a plain in Shinar and settled there. They said to each other, "Come, let's make bricks and bake them thoroughly." They used brick instead of stone and tar for mortar. Then they said, "Come, let us build ourselves a city with a tower that reaches to the heavens, so that we may make a name for ourselves. Otherwise, we will be scattered over the face of the earth." But the Lord came down to see the city and the tower the people were building. The Lord said, "If, as one people speaking the same language, they have begun to do this, then nothing they plan to do will be impossible for them. Come, let us go down and confuse their language so they will not understand each other." So the Lord scattered them from there all over the earth, and they stopped building the city. That is why it was called Babel, because there the Lord confused the language of the whole world. From there the Lord scattered them over the face of the whole earth. This is the account of Shem's family line. 2 years after the flood, then Shem was 100 years old. He became the father of Arphaxad. And after he became the father of Arphaxad, Shem lived 500 years and had other sons and daughters. A key but subtle theme hinges on this word east. God sent Adam and Eve east when he pushed them out of the garden. When Cain was expelled from God's presence for slaughtering his brother, the text says he went east as well. The letter east represents a journey away from God. So, when we see the people gather in a valley in the land of Shinar in the east, the author is implying that the next scene will take humanity further away from God. The people at Babylon or Babel made a declaration of independence, not from another nation, but from God himself. "Let us build ourselves a city and a tower with its top in the sky. Let us make a name for ourselves." To construct a city was to build civilization. To construct a tower was to construct a religious order. Both would be man-centered efforts rather than God-centered ones. They were embracing a type of humanism. Instead of pursuing God's agenda of multiplying and filling the earth, they wanted to do everything they could to avoid being scattered across the globe. In some ways, they desired what most teenagers today desire, independence, with all of its benefits, while still enjoying the benefits of living at home under parental supervision. In this scene, humanity says to God, "Keep putting food on my table and clothes on my back, but don't tell me what to do. Continue to bless me, but do not instruct me." The people of Shinar desired to construct a tower with its top in the sky, reaching all the way to heaven. What happened after that? God descended to survey the city and the tower. People believed they could construct their own physical and spiritual worlds using man-made religion and technology, brick and mortar. But even God had to stoop down to see what they were doing. It makes no difference how high you climb. The only way to reach God is for him to come down to you. Nimrod was a great person. However, the strongest man in the Bible was also imperfect. To watch the story of Samson, click here.